dibawakan oleh Dr. Firdaus Hanapiah. Pertama-tama diberitahukan kepada para peserta, dimohon untuk mematikan handphone atau alat-alat lain yang suaranya dapat mengganggu selama ceramah ilmiah. Dan juga diberitahukan kepada para peserta, selama ceramah berlangsung, silakan untuk menginterupsi dan mengajukan pertanyaan apabila ada yang kurang apabila ada poin-poin yang kurang jelas ataupun istilah-istilah yang dirasa tidak dimengerti, silakan langsung menanyakan dan menginterupsi. Baiklah, untuk efektivitas waktu, saya perkenalkan terlebih dahulu pembicara kita kali ini, yaitu Dr. Firdaus Hanapiah. Beliau mendapatkan gelar Bachelor of Dental Surgery dari Universitas of Otago, Selandia Baru, dan juga mendapatkan gelar Master of Science di bedah mulut di Eastman, dan juga mendapatkan gelar Fellowship dalam bedah gigi dari England. Kemudian juga beliau merupakan mendapatkan gelar Fellowship Congress International Implantologist, dan hingga hari ini beliau telah melakukan kurang lebih 6.000 implant kepada pasiennya. Dan kali ini kita akan membahas mengenai the utilization of the one piece dental implant in the oral rehabilitation of the patient. Sekali lagi, saya ingatkan kepada para peserta ceramah ilmiah kali ini, selama ceramah berlangsung, apabila ada istilah ataupun poin-poin yang tidak dimengerti, silakan langsung saja menginterupsi dan juga mengajukan pertanyaan. Jangan khawatir, setiap pertanyaan nanti kami akan beri merchandise dari sponsor. Baiklah, Dr. Firdaus, time and place is yours, please.
Thank you very much. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya ucapkan kepada dan selamat sejahtera kepada semua partisipan-partisipan di sini. Saya mohon maaf kerana bahasa saya ini kurang sedikit ya. Jadi saya mohon berbahasa Inggris kerana bahasa Inggris saya sedikit lebih baik daripada bahasa saya. Okay, thank you very much. I'd like to apologize if my bahasa is not so good because my training is in English, but if there's any question that you want to ask, please do so in both in bahasa and also in English, any which one will do. Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee for inviting me to speak in your program, in the PDGI, official PDGI program. And I think it's a marvel to see such many who can come right after Eid al-Fitri, yeah? Because in Eid al-Fitri in Malaysia, we have open houses, and this is the right time for open houses and weddings, so people have no time for education. So when I see so many people who come to a single speaker session, so I'm very touched and I'm very awed and humble. Humility to you people who are ready to share knowledge. So today's session is a knowledge gathering session. That means that knowledge does not come from one side but for both. So I'd like to have interaction with you. My topic today is the utilization of the one-piece dental implant in the oral rehabilitation of the patient. I am in prior practice, but I am also a consultant oromaxillofacial surgeon for UITM, which is a new university in Shah Alam. Shah Alam is a provincial province capital, yeah, of Selangor. In terms of introduction, I would like to say that when we talk about implant placement, it's become routine. Today, when I started off as a university student and undergraduate in New Zealand, yeah, those implants were placed by specialists, ultra specialist professors, and we would come to a stage where the patient is put under general anesthesia, and we watch from the high podium to see our our surgeon placed, Victim surgeon placed this implant. Okay, that was back in 1985-86 when the first implant was introduced in New Zealand. Today, osseointegration should not be something that we question. It's a fact, it's been known that titanium placed in the bone, it will integrate. Okay, so the modern implant system, the question of integration does not arise anymore. But however, because of the common placement of implant, there is a high expectation because you know your patient been telling other patients about how wonderful their new teeth are. So nowadays, patient wants instant teeth. They want good looks. They want no pain, and they want less pain in the pocket. Okay. So this is most probably the last factor is the one that really stops the patient from coming to you today. Yeah? So this is the thing. And then the clinical expectation of a clinician is that he wants to start implant, he dream of doing implant dentistry. I can see some undergraduate and some postgraduates, you know, the first few years of postgraduate work, they want something that they can wake up tomorrow and do it very easily. They want something that can integrate very fast. That means the next couple of weeks, after placement of implant, they can already restore this patient. They want good pink and white aesthetic. That means that the thing should not just look feels like teeth, but they should look like teeth, okay? And they want manageable costs so that they can have some good margin when they place the implant. And also they want good support from the manufacturer. That means the people who supplies them implant must give them not just a piece of titanium that they can place in the patient, but something that can last a long time and support. That means if there's any problem, the manufacturer can come back and you can go back to the manufacturer and you are given good support. Okay. Easy procedure. As you know, the designers of implants are engineers. Engineers tend to think very mechanically, so they don't envisage the problem that we have as clinicians. And as you know, the so-called original modern implants were designed thoroughly by engineers. Okay, so they have this very little understanding what clinical procedure we do, and this is a problem that the clinician have because there are too many components. So clinicians tend to have too many components, and that makes our surgical and prosthetic procedure more complex and more error-prone. Because once you put in an extra component in a procedure, this will compound the problem if it was not corrected earlier. So, Brandemark, as you know, was the father of integration. We will talk about him later. But he says this is the thing that we have to go through, a protocol. That you take as a dogma, you learn about it, you don't question too much about it, but if you do what Professor Brandemark says, you will get good results. Okay? So these are the things that we as a clinician will take hold. Okay? So there's a debate in the old days about which is a better implant, the smooth or the rough surface. The clinician wants earlier loading time, they want something that is very fast, so they want something that can integrate within 9 weeks in the mandible and 12 weeks in the maxilla. Okay? They want a good aesthetic, that means reliable prosthetic, reproducibility, that means that the implant that you pull place for patient A can also be reproduced in patient B. They want something that can maintain good bone level, that means that you know, you're going to see this patient in the year 2011. Hopefully, you'll see the patient again in the year 2021 with the same implant that you placed in 2010 with good maintenance of the bone level. Okay? You want good pink and white aesthetic, as I said before. The cost must be, hopefully, go down. Because I remember the days when we placed an implant back in New Zealand, it costs equivalent to around $14,000 in those days, okay? And people took it, you know? That is why early implant dentists in Southeast Asia, particularly in Singapore, made their money within the next 5 years, and they retired for life because they came early and they did all the implants and they made the money. Okay, but today they are, of course, more of us doing implants, so there is what you call a realization of the cost, and cost hopefully with the competition of manufacturers will come down to a point that all our patients can afford this. This is the ideal, in the so-called egalitarian ideal world. Yeah. So the cost must go down so that we, as well as the patient, can have a good bottom line. Price is right, but the standard must also be good. So from the manufacturer side, we'd love to have a good certification. We want further education from the manufacturer. They can provide technical expertise. They can emphasize on research, what they've done, and quality assurance that they come with the implant. That means they are able to say, "Good, this implant, you know, if there's anything wrong with the manufacturing, we will give you support or give you a good assurance on it." So the definition of clinical situation, you can say in basically these categories. The classic delayed implantation, the immediate implantation, the delayed immediate implantation, the delayed loading, early loading, and immediate loading. So these are the six things. They are very, very confusing for the first timers. But over the time, I also get confused sometimes, but I recant myself, and I think you know, I can rationalize the logic behind these processes. Yeah. So delayed implantation is something that Brenwick thought up because he wanted something that is safe, and so he can guarantee that people who starts off doing implant will have successful implant. His concept is by today's standard quite conservative, in the sense that placement of implant are done a few months after the extraction of a teeth, of a tooth. But the advantage of this is that it gives you a safe, proven technique. You have very good stable bone. It's preferred when there's active periodontal disease. But the disadvantage is that there is a loss of crestal bone. There's a prolonged treatment time. There's a lot of unnecessary hassle for the patient. If you place an implant and you wait for, when you extract teeth, you have to wait. You have to construct a denture. And then you place the implant, you wait, wait again. This is the what you call the delayed implantation. Yeah. So an example of a case: a 42-year-old female was referred from a dental clinic to our center, complaining of a broken right lateral incisor. She is medically fit with no known allergy. She is a dentist, working in a very well prominent clinic in Kuala Lumpur. So this is a patient that you know you have to think twice. I touch anything, you know. So it's a very, very insecure patient as well because she's practicing that issue. Upon examination, we found a can we switch off the lights a little bit? Because maybe you cannot see very well. Okay, upon examination, we found a vertically fractured retained root which was previously endodontically treated. This is one of the sequela of tooth which is already root canal. Yeah? So today we are placing post calls and things like that. Over the years, you know, you can see this cure, but a lot of the cases that I see, I don't know if you guys see it, but after 10 to 15 years, these teeth start to come back with a cut vertical fracture. And they have, usually they will come back with a loose post call. You cement them in, we use the best resin you can get. You acid edge, you bond, you put in the, you know, crown back in. I'm not a prosthodontist, so I don't do this sort of work, yeah? But I can see them. 2 weeks later, they come back. Oh, doctor, this has come back. So, okay, never mind. I will put in another post-core. I make you a new one. Put it in. 6 months later, they come back. Same problem. So what I believe is that there is already a vertical fracture within the tooth. When you x-ray, you don't see anything. So these are quite small fractures, and they tend to widen, and then they undermine the post. Okay, so that's what happened to her. She's been, you know, endodontically treated post. One day it just comes off, and she cemented in, it comes up again. Okay, so we found that there is a vertical fracture. She was wearing a denture which was hastily made in her clinic after the loss of her postdoc. So she's not very happy, she had to cancel a patient, and that's what she had. Okay, her expectation was reasonably high. She didn't want to wear a denture at all, she wants to have an aesthetic result. She didn't want a fixed bridge, because she knows that, you know, if she has to take those other teeth out, by prep them, yeah? And those are nice, unrestored teeth. Cost wasn't a prime concern for her. Of course, she's well-to-do because she's in a prominent practice. She wants to have implant and watch it quick. This is the prima donna of patients. You don't want to handle it every day. If you do, then you have to go to see some you know, medical psychiatrist to get yourself fixed. You may have high blood pressure afterwards. Yeah. Okay. So a PA was taken. I forgot to put the PA again. But it shows the radiolucency. You'll see some of the OPG. Yeah. Radiolucency of the lateral incisor. So the diagnosis of vertical fracture of the 1-2 and a periapical granuloma. Extraction of the 1-2 root surgically removed. Place some beta-tricalcium phosphate. Placement of resin bonded bridge immediately after surgical. I'll show you the picture here. Immediate implant was not possible due to the lack of primary stability as well as risk of impacted socket. So the case was delayed for 12 weeks. This is the sort of case. We extracted the tools. As you can see, there's a huge perforation there. A granuloma was taken out and biopsied, and that's how it looked like. Yeah? So I had to extract the tooth. Even if I had an implant, I would not put it in there because there was also signs of infection. Okay, that's OPG. You can see the lucency in this area. You can see that, yeah? We managed to take impression, make a quick resin bonded bridge, so-called Rocher or Maryland bridge, yeah? Temporary resin bridge was maintained, socket was left. 12 weeks with beta-tricalcium phosphate graft, surgical template made as part of the planning, placement of the implant on the day. This is the once the resin is taken, resin bridge was removed. You can see a heel ridge, 2.0 diameter initial bridge. I use a bihorizon in this case. This was about 6 or 7 years ago. I was doing lots of bihorizon. Placement of the 2.5 diameter twist drill. Placement alignment. You can see this is the sort of alignment that you like, and you can vaguely see that there is already bone. Yeah. With the graft that we placed. Okay, so a thread, 3.5 millimeter thread they use, up to the 12 millimeter depth as planned at slow speed at 15 RPM. Placement of implant placed in the socket at a gentle 20 RPM. That's how it looks like. Not so good with the picture, but note the depth of the interior. You want to put the interior teeth here, tips for the surgeons here. Yeah? In anterior teeth, you want to put it 2 millimeter below the crest, if you can. And that gives you a really good emergence profile. Blood closure with vitreal 3-0 resin bridge reinserted, acoxia, gave her 120 milligram next 3 days, no antibiotics were given because she's a very healthy lady, so I don't see any point of giving antibiotics. 4 months integration time given, consideration thin periapical plate of the grafting of the bone, yeah? The prosthetics stage 16 long weeks later, re-entry done, healing abutment place, healing period of 2 weeks before final impression. You can see a bihorizon with a ball top screw, they can quite nicely heal. And x-ray taken to make sure the impression coping is in place. You can see that, yeah? Grafted side is healed. I'm very happy with that, considering there was a hole there 4 months prior. And that's the result. I'm so sorry, but the color of the picture is not so good because of the flash, but really in practice it looks quite good. Okay, delayed implantation. All together it took 30 weeks. That's more than half a year. Okay, so half a year the patient goes around with the resin bonded bridge and the denture. This is something that I feel that we can work better on. Yeah? So immediate implantation is the way to go. Okay, so these pictures, some of them are when the first digital camera came up, so I took them. Yeah? the immediate replacement of an implant after tooth extraction. So I had another patient, immediate implantation after extraction of teeth, an example of clinical situation, a 59-year-old, I go clinical, yeah, because I know you've had a lot of theories and things like that. I think on a Saturday, people might just want to see some of the cases.
Dr. Firdaus, I'm sorry for interrupting you. Diingatkan kepada para peserta apabila terlalu cepat atau juga apabila ada pertanyaan, silakan langsung saja menginterupsi kemudian mengajukan pertanyaan. Baik.
Okay, we got a whole morning. Okay, no problem. Terima kasih. So a 59-year-old lady who came to see us 9 years lost to fall. That means that I saw this patient way back in 1992. Okay. And then she was lost. Actually, she did not get lost. I got lost. Because I went away to United Kingdom for 7 years. Or for 5 years, I think. Yeah. So she then came back to see me after I come back, you know, asking, where were you? Where were you? For 5 years I've been looking for you. Or for 9 years I've been looking for you. Okay? So, look at that. A failing 6-unit bridge. Yeah? Mobility from palpation constructed 10 years previously. And guess who is the prosthodontist? I am the prosthodontist. That is why if you cannot do good crown, good bridge, you can't do dentures well, what do you do? You do oral surgery. Okay. So that's what I did. I went to UK, I did oral surgery and came back. And then I saw this patient, yeah? So basically, what happened is you can see the black stuff there. The whole bridge was not well. Well, it was well placed. I claim it was well placed 10 years ago. I blame the patient, yeah, because she did not take the care. Okay, so she had a little bit of recurrent caries, and when I had looked at that, the decision was made to remove the bridge. And it had undermining caries underneath, yeah, and structurally it was irreparable. Okay, so three alternatives we can give to this patient. We can remove bridge, remove the affected teeth, place longer span bridge. But the problem is when you go longer and longer, you will be more biomechanically unsound because you have more pontics to support. Yeah, you can remove the bridge, place denture. This is unacceptable patient because the patient cannot accept the denture. She doesn't want denture. Remove bridge, place immediate implant, provisional prosthesis, then place tooth implant support bridge. That means that on the day I extract the teeth, I place the implant straight away. Okay, you can see this is the date that I did this, yeah, in 03. So patient chose to the third option. So we remove the bridge, place immediate implant. However, due to budget constraints, if patient can only afford the two implants, but at least when you extract teeth and place implant straight into the socket where you extracted the tooth, you have only one surgical stage. That means that the patient does not go through again, you know, extract teeth like what Brandmark said, leave it for 3 months and then place another implant. It's too long. Yeah? This time you extract teeth and place implant straight away. This is if you are an implant dentist, you know that this is a very old slide because that sign there gives it away. This is Stereos. This company does not exist anymore. This is now part of Nobel Biocare. Okay? So we do a lots and lots of these Stereos. These are American implants. Yeah? So we took out the bridge, removed, saw all the tooth abutment compromised, three compromised tooth removed, and two implants placed. So that's one of the implants placed on the day. And these are the two implants. And then we found that the back one is still okay. We re-prepped it and then use it as a final impression. As you can see there. And then there she is with an implant tooth supported bridge. Okay? Implant tooth supported bridge. Okay? Some people will say, Dr. Firdaus, can you do that? Okay. Some people don't like, you know, if you put implant to teeth, what happens? Implant fixed teeth are movable. Okay, over the years they say there will be failure of either or both. But I followed up this lady for last 03 to now, 8 years, so far so good. Okay, there's no change in the periodontal component or the component of the back. Maybe the tooth is ankylosed. who knows, yeah. Okay, that's how she looks like with a fixed prosthesis. She's very happy. So the immediate implantation is half the time. Yeah? This is quite up by the German delayed immediate. How can you have a delayed and then immediate? See, this is a placement implant within the 3 weeks after extraction. Sometimes you don't want to take tooth out and then place implant because you have lots of infection maybe, yeah, in the socket. So you clean the socket, you retouch it, and then 3 weeks later come in and place the implant. The advantage is that there's no periodontal, well, hopefully there's no periodontal infection there. The disadvantage is sometimes you lose too much bone, and when you place the implant, you have no primary stability. Okay? So, I would like to have you think of a paradigm shift. If you think of it, if you have a time as a dentist and you have the know-how of an engineer, how would you reinvent the dental implant? Okay? What would you like to be incorporated? I thought of it at night, Batsu was talking to me, do you sleep at night? I said, no, I don't sleep at night. All I have to do is find the nearest plug and I recharge myself. Okay? So I can think. So one of the things I do is that I would like to have incorporated, and if I was inventing a new implant system, the future making it simple as teeth. That means, like Ford said, do you know who Ford is? Henry Ford? Okay? Cars for the people. Okay? Car for the masses. Okay? So I want to give everybody the chance of, you know, this is my ideal dream. I might be a bit megalomaniac in that sense, I don't know. So features that make it simple as teeth, that you don't have to learn too much. Well, you have to learn, of course. You're learning dentistry, is already a 5-year course, isn't it? Is it a 5-year course here? Yeah. Isn't that long enough?
It's only the beginning.
You don't want to finish and then people say it's the beginning of, not the beginning of beginning, but the beginning of the end for you. So you don't want to, you know. So features that makes it simple as teeth, no screw required, zero learning curve on our part, which is ideally, of course, there's no such thing as a zero learning curve. I can do it fast and it cost less, so that my bottom margin is better. Okay, so that I can do less work for more money. Okay, it's one of the things. I found, well, somebody said that if you work faithfully for it, yeah? Okay? So another case report, yeah? I think. Okay, this is a lady who was a dental student in year 4, in year 2004. And she came to see us, and I then, from an orthodontist. And she presented to me with a milk tooth, an impacted canine, and a tooth that came off the week previously. Okay, so this is the case that we saw. What would you do in this case? Okay, you can close the gap. Can you close the gap? For sure you can. Yeah? You can get an orthodontist to just take out the tooth and then close the gap. But what happened to the tooth on top? Do we leave it there for a long time? And pat her on the back and they say, okay, see me when you are 35. Yeah? Extract impacted teeth? Yeah, you can do that. Go in and take out the tooth? Yeah, of course. Implants? Yes, you can give implants. But this is, remember, this is a year 4 student who's got, in Malaysia we have what you call a PTPL, yeah? PTPL is that you get the money from the government, and then after you finish your degree, you pay back. And it will take your whole life to pay back. Loan, yeah. Okay? And then implants? Not at the year 3, because they can't afford it, okay? Transplant? Okay, so what I did for this patient was that I did think about the transplant, because this is quite ideal for transplant. The patient will one day become a dentist, she can afford the implant. But today she can't, so she's got her implants inside, yeah? So that's what I did. I opened up the area here, and then I then took out the tooth with the follicle next to it. I put in some graft, HA plus a little bit of beta-graft calcium phosphate. I mix it. I make my own cooking recipe. Okay? And then I place it back in where the big hole was. Okay? And then Knowing me, I do dental implant. I'm an oral surgeon. I always have a mallet in my theater. So I used a drill for the implant, make it as just enough size, but slightly smaller than the diameter of the implant. I took my mallet and whacking. Like I do, you know, something like, you don't play croquet here, do you? No. Like golf, but before golf. Yeah. Okay. So it goes in like a croquet. So that's how it looks like after surgery. Okay. So the result, me and we did it with Dr. Hao Kim Chuan, who's also my orthodontic partner. And that's how it looks like. See, this is the tooth that was 6 months previously inside the gum. Yeah? It's fully integrated. So but basically what happened is it's ankylosed. Yeah? Ankylosed in place. And what you do with that, if you have this sort of work, you root canal the tooth. Okay? Ira, please stop me if you have the time, if the time is too much. Yeah. So once, if you can see, this is the OPG. I took out the tooth and placed it where it is. But look at that. Yeah. I placed HA plus by the beta tricalcium phosphate, and it looks wonderful. Okay. So it shows that if this is the other thing I want to show you, if you have sockets, yeah, if you take out tooth. You will help yourself. Okay, if you find that there's no primary stability, the patient may not be able to support implant. But think about another couple of years. Maybe he or wants to have implant. When you take out teeth, put in the graft. Charge a little bit on the patient, because it'll make your life easier later when the patient comes back and you want to place an implant there. Okay? See, this shows to me that a big hole can be plugged in within like 6 months. And that's beautiful bone. Okay, it's beta tricalcium plus the HA. Yes, sir.
So you
clean
the hole.
Mm-hmm.
You took out the teeth.
Yep.
You clean the hole and then you place back.
Yep.
Is it the original teeth?
The original tooth. Okay, but be sure which one. Don't put the 1-3 and the 2-3 and the 2-3 and the 1-3. Okay, it has happened before. Okay, that's a good question. Yeah, that's what I did. And if the primary stability is not good, what you do is you put in a 0.2 wire, and you splint it to the next tooth. And if you're a prosthodontist or a restorative dentist, even better. You put in a little bit of composite and you splint it. It's much better because you want less rigidity. The less rigidity on primary stability of these teeth, the more preservation the root I find. Okay. The more rigid it is, the faster it ankylos, the faster you get root resorption. Okay, so that patient there, just now, is the ultimate implant because it's patient's own teeth. Okay? Okay, we will never have the ideal case, of course, in reality, because patient having extra tooth for transplantation is a rarity. Yeah? Okay?
Excuse me, yes,
Yes. Tina, yeah.
I'm sorry to ask you, why you put the HA into the, and then it with the,
I find that at that time, yeah, this is 2000. You saw that 2004. I find that at that time, HA and beta hydroxyapatite phosphate works well, in which HA is resolved very fast, and then the beta hydroxyapatite phosphate is resolved very fast. HA then holds the scaffolding, and then bone comes together. Okay.
So the HA is a scaffolding.
As scaffold.
Okay.
All right. That's a good question. Okay. So stem cell research for designer transplantable teeth are a long way off because people are talking about genetic engineering these days. They can grow teeth in a petri. They think they can, but it's not like liver. Liver you can grow. Even lung component you can grow in a petri dish. But teeth are very complicated. You know, you learn. Dental anatomy, it's a really complex. It's more maybe as complex as the brain. Yeah. Okay. So stem cell research are slightly on a long way off. So the innovation here is to invent an implant that simulate what the tooth should be, a root that is completely in sync with the crown, a crown which can be prepared in the mouth like any tooth to get the best primary stability that is possible upon insertion, the highest torque insertion. That means that. Something that's very stable. you know, you tighten it to clinically acceptable top insertion release. Okay. What is old may be new again. Okay. In Egyptian time, in terms of historical perspective, if you look at some of the work, if you watch even Discovery Channel, you can see that ivory has been placed in a lot of the teeth of the ruling class. Tooth transplantation occurred. You know what? You have auto transplantation like we did today, yeah? But in the old days, there was in Middle East Europe, something happened quite fast. It's called the Industrial Revolution. Okay, the Industrial Revolution was triggered because the European discovered the Spice Island. In fact, the London Stock Exchange, yeah, in London, was actually a spice trading house. It started off as a spice trading house, and Indonesia and Malaysia was responsible for the beginning of the Industrial Revolution because we accumulated wealth for these people. But with wealth came along other things, like exotic food. One of the things that was brought into Europe, which was not present in the Middle Ages, was sugar. Sugar cane, and sugar was very expensive. So who can eat sugar? The very rich. And what happened to the very rich when they eat sugar without fluoride and the toothbrush? They get decayed. And who had the best teeth? The peasants. But who got the money? The rich, the ruling class. So what happened was the ruling class then came to the peasant. What nice teeth you have. I got cruddy teeth. So he called the barber surgeon down in King's Cross. He said, can you, the barber surgeon, take teeth from the poor and put it into my tooth? And that's what they did. It's a gory thing. But that is the reality of it. Yeah. So they actually bought teeth from the poor people to be placed into the rich people. It all came from this country, from Indonesia and Malaysia. Because they became rich because of us. And they get the suffering of tooth decay because of us as well. So they deserve it.
Brings new meaning to revenge is sweet, huh?
Yeah. Okay, but what happened is that those teeth, of course, do not last because they are probably crudely wired together and then you have infection, things like that. But it's a good trait. And the barber surgeon then became surgeons. And they started the Royal College of Surgeons of England, Ireland, and whatnot, you know. So the other thing that happened was in 1809, a fellow called Maggiolio fabricated a gold implant. He wrote about it, and he placed it into a fresh extraction socket to which he attached a tooth after a certain healing period. And he found that there's some cases that they do work. Of course, you have what you call fibro. We know that as fibro integration today. In 1887, a physician by the name of Harris attempted the same procedure but with a platinum post instead of gold post, and he also found that partial success in placement of these gold platinum implants. But really, Stock was probably the first somewhat successful oral implant in Harvard University in 1937. He published a paper on the physiological effect of vitellium in bone. Okay, he found that there is some so-called integration. And he did some work, and some of his work, I think, lasted, some of the implants that he made lasted until the 1950s. So the modern perspective of implant was that you had this implant evolved within from the 1930s onward, and you have the endo-osseal blade, the ramus frame, the endo-osseal root form, and the cylindrical implant. We know today that the father of modern implant is Per Ingmar Brandmark, who was an orthopedic surgeon. Yeah? He was an orthopedic surgeon. He discovered it by accident. He had a nice story to tell, that he had an optical chamber housed in a titanium metal cylinder, which he studied blood vessel flow in the femur of a rabbit, or thigh bone of a rabbit. The titanium, after 6 weeks when he sacrificed the rabbit, he tried to take off the cylinder from the optical cylinder from the bone. He could not, because those cylinders were made out of titanium. And that spawned an idea. He said, look, we can make things out of this, something that is can be fused to the bone. Maybe we can make teeth out of it. Yeah. So he then, he was not a dentist, he was an orthopedic surgeon. Okay? So a lot of, he had some dentist friend, but a lot of his design went to an engineer, the engineering people. So is this the absolute truth, or is this a nice story? Okay? Do you know this guy? Yeah, very good. Leonardo da Vinci. Not a lot of people knew, well, not a lot of people knew that he drew this painting in Mona Lisa, yeah? Okay. However, not a lot of people knew that he also did a lot of anatomical pictures, he did a lot of drawings, he made a lot of observation, a lot of books, and other inventions as well. One of which was the spinal blade, a helical blade, you know, today. This is quite significant in dentistry. Sorry, I'm ignoring the group here. Forgotten, there is another lecture theater. Can you see? Can you hear me? Yeah? Okay, I'm so sorry. I should be here, you know? Right in the middle. Okay, second half, I stay there. Okay, sorry, yeah? Okay, so, but did you know that this guy, who? Anybody know who about this guy? His name is Leonard Linkow. For all purpose knowledge, this guy's still alive today, you know? He's 93 years old. He still lives in, I think, in upstate New York somewhere. And you can actually email him, and he will answer back. I don't know if it's him or his ghost, but somebody's answering, you know? Okay? His implant, as of 2 weeks ago, I found another one of his implant. Okay? It's amazing. Okay? So his name is Leonard Linkow. He's an American guy. No such thing as original idea. Ideas are rehashed and rebranded and re-improved. You know, that shows that in this world, there's always room for improvement. Whatever we do, there's room for improvement, and when we become too complicated, we have to look back and look at something that's simple again. So the one-piece immediately loaded implant system, we call it Novella implant system. This is something that I thought of, you know, during my recharging session, yeah? So the objective of a Novella implant system to make a simple system that both clinician as well as patient is happy with. To take a biologically more compatible and to reduce shortcoming of previous system. To optimize the treatment time for patient and maximize the turnaround time for clinician. To reduce cost of both clinician and patient. So is the word now, you know, democratization. The new word, you know, of implant dentistry. So that the elite, not just the elite, can do implant. Everybody. It sounds like now everybody can have implant, yeah?
Now everybody can afford to smile.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, so to make a simpler system for both clinician as well as patient, a system that reduces the integration time, a system that doesn't need too much tooling, an implant system that doesn't have any component, both surgical and prosthetic, make my life easier and your life, you know, as a surgeon easy and a prosthodontist easy, yeah? So, biologically more compatible and to reduce the shortcoming of previous system. A one-piece implant does not have to have an abutment and a fixture interface, therefore eliminating the issue of bone loss or micro gap, yeah? Tidak ada micro gap. That's, for me, is the thing. The one-piece implant has thicker walls, and therefore, I believe in narrower circumstances where there's a narrow implant, they are actually stronger than the hollow wall conventional implant of equivalent diameter. Okay? To optimize clinical time for patients and to minimize turnaround time for clinicians, a one-stage surgery with an option of flapless method. That means that if you want to do flapless, you can. If you want to open a flap, also you can. And can incorporate immediate provisionalization. That means I can put in a temporary crown when I have to. There's no need for second stage and less visit to the dental clinic. Okay? So I want something that has less component, there's no healing abutment, no impression coping, no analog, no prosthetic base to prepare like normal teeth. If you're a prosthodontist, very comfortable in cutting crown and bridge, making shoulders, making beautiful shoulders. Why not use your skill as a clinician to do that, rather than trust on the technician to make your margin? Okay, so that's what I want. Okay, that means yeah, you are more in control. Today I feel the problem is that when you have an implant, the level of implant is there, and then the prosthetic technician is more in control than you are. Okay. What else? No analog, no prosthetic face. You prepare like normal with tungsten carbide burr. Yeah? I use tungsten carbide burr. I can prepare it like in 10-15 minutes. Okay, I show you one case, the case report. Yeah? This is a 60-year-old guy. Can you see on this side? Okay? I'm so sorry about the glare, but I promise you I will go to the second session. Yeah? Okay, 60-year-old male who lost 4-unit bridge 6 weeks before. This guy was a diplomat. He went to Turkey. He had all his teeth done in Turkey, the lower ones in Turkey. The upper one just collapsed. So I placed 2 months previously, I placed one immediate implant here, and the rest are all conventional plus immediate implants. So he said, He's very happy with the concept of immediate implant because he doesn't like to wear dentures. Like most people do not like to wear dentures. I don't know anybody who likes to wear dentures, frankly speaking. I don't think people wake up in the morning, I want to wear my denture. So that's the thing. So he lost 4-unit bridge 6 weeks before, and at that time we felt that he was ready for the implant. We plan for 4 implants in this area. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We have what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 teeth, 4 implants. Okay, impression taken from the model. It is simple stuff, you know. I like to simulate something that you would do in a general dentist clinic. Nothing fancy. But I'll show you something in the fanciest stuff later on, yeah? Okay, that's what we did. We then did the surgical phase. On the day, I use a high-speed burr to obliterate the mucosa, ablate the mucosa. So then I go in with a high-speed burr with adequate water until I find periosteum. I feel the bone, I break the periosteum. Okay? I do not use a punch. Because I find punch are wasteful. You lose the keratinized tissue. And you're certainly not there anyway. When you use a punch, sometimes it's still messy. It's rather exact when you use a burr, a big round burr, you go in, you find the periosteum, you feel bone, you stop. Okay? You burn a little bit of the bone, maybe 0.5 millimeter on the surface. You know, you got lots of water there. Okay? Maybe this is because of my oral surgery training. I don't count too much on the millimeters, but here you go, 2.2 millimeter, fifth drill in. Alignment check. Okay. Note that I use a Straumann instrument. Okay. We have our Novella has its own instrument, but if you have a Straumann implant system in your home or in your clinic, what would you want to do in the home? In the clinic, you can use it as the okay. So alignment check with that, and then we place the 3 diameter implant. Okay? Note that this is also a Straumann carrier and it goes into the adapter easily. Okay? That's how it is. So then we top wrench it, it's in, the second one comes in, and it's in. That's about maybe 10-15 minutes. 20 minutes later, everything is in. Okay? 4 implants were placed. That's how the. As you can see, no bleeding, no flap open, and reasonably aligned, as much as I can. The prostodontist can do better than this, because I'm an oral surgeon, remember? You can't do crown and bridge, you can't do dentures, because I'm an oral surgeon, yeah? Okay. But oral surgeon, we like to extract, we take out surgical work, it's more for us, yeah? More destruction. Okay. A silicone impression, remember we did on the model? We fit it in, we make sure that it fits. So you don't make sure that you are in the right patient. Okay. And then we use the ProTem. Yeah, ProTem. I think you have this product from BM. ProTem 4. And what we do, I'm missing a few slides. We use this ProTem. We inject it into the mold, and we press it into the. And then we have this bit here. A bit of deficit, of course. So what I did was then I add on a bit of composite on it, fuse all four together, and it becomes a rigid unit. Yeah. And then we use a lacquer the whole lot, and it becomes a fuse. And he goes home with teeth, which is fixed. No bleeding, no pain. Why no pain? Because we don't take out periosteum. Pain comes in when you strip periosteum. I find, we're doing some clinical trial in Malaysia. Maybe you can prove, you know, I'll give you the idea now. I'm doing implant one, both sides. One side I open flap, the other side I don't open flap. Then I monitor the bone level. I monitor the quality of life of the patient after surgery. Which side gives him more trouble? And I look at survival rates. So opening. Okay, so it's simple stuff. Okay, so as you can see, he's got all these are all implants except for that tooth there. That's the only natural tooth he has. Okay, second case, this is a rigid fixed bridge. That's how it looks like. No teeth. She came to see me a few years before. We put in BioHorizon. Sorry, but the OPG is a bit pushed up. I trimmed it a little bit and left it there for the next 2 to 3 months. There's no problem. Leave the little post in there. You know, you do the same. If you do a salmon, I think it's most
popular. I think it's a 3i or life core implant. Yeah? Open tray technique. The prosto people will know better. Yeah. Make sure impression coping is forced through the tray. Take the impression, get the bite. Superstructure mounted. I think this will be...